Hi, everyone, and good afternoon. It's my great pleasure to open the Screen-Based Art Department seminar, Video Art, the First 50 Years. The seminar title is, of course, the name of the recently published book by one of our honorable guests, Barbara London. Being the head of this remarkable department at Bezalel Academy during the coronavirus means that one of my concerns is what will be the academic added value for our students when this surreal time passes. What memory will diffuse in our 320 students' minds and hearts, and how will it be translated to their future creation? Event like this assures me that one of the meaningful things that our students will look back at will be the ability to meet inspiring guests such as Barbara London and John Gartenberg online, talking about the most relevant subject and aspect of our artistic field. And the second reason that I'm so delighted about this seminar is the possibility of discussing a bigger perspective than this last significant year. 50 years with their ups and downs, with different technologies that were perceived as cutting edge and today looks out of date. 50 years of different cultural context in which video art was created increases the understanding that the field in which we create is wider than any specific epidemic, stronger than any lockdown, and give us all an optimistic reminder that spirit is stronger than anything we know. And that one of the ways to come stronger out of this situation is always to remember that our creation is bigger than daily life. I want to thank Barbara London and John Gartenberg for taking the time to be here today to share the knowledge with us. I would like to thank Sharon Balaban for organizing this seminar. I want to thank Eitan, Ofer and Amma that helped to produce this afternoon. I hope that the next year we will meet face to face, maybe to celebrate 51 years of video art. I wish you all an eye-opener seminar. Enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you, Tami. And I would like to thank you for helping make this special event materialize. Thank you. And to all the wonderful guests here, Zili Chani from New York, Vivian Ostrovsky, curators, students, faculty. I would like to present Barbara. Barbara London, no, just Barbara, I'm presenting you now.
Yeah, yeah.
Barbara London carved the way we perceive video art today. Her professional path is our syllabus. A New York native living and experiencing an era of political and technological shifts, Barbara captured the pulse and paved the way to what has become one of the major realms of contemporary art. Initially, video makers hated museums as much as they hated TV, but her vision and unconventional thinking opened the door for this medium to one of the most powerful institutions, the Museum of Modern Art, a museum defining art and cultural narratives till today. The book Video Art, The First 50 Years, published last January, just before COVID hit, is a phenomenal work on so many levels. But first and foremost, in an era of major technological leaps and changes affecting our lives today, Barbara's path is an example of visionary perception and action in revolutionary times. London vibrantly brings these histories to life. Her writing, a manifestation of her extensive knowledge and research, is also full of humor and wit. I had to bring up this example when describing early video artists, open quote, passing a camera around as easily as a joint, end quote, and not that I'm recommending anything here. A professor at Yale and Columbia, her honors include major grants and fellowships, Getty Research Institute Scholar, the Courage Award from IBEAM, and the National Endowment for the Arts Fellowship, just to name a few. During her 40 years at MoMA, London curated a long list of seminal solo exhibitions and group exhibitions, and her latest exhibition outside of MoMA, called Seeing Sound, offers immersive encounters with sound as art, and it was produced by Independent Curators International. The show will tour for the next 4 years, and of course, you have to know the fabulous podcast, Barbara London Calling. You have to check it out and subscribe. So I don't know if it's a good idea, but please open your mics and give a really, really warm welcome to Barbara London.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Sharon. And thank you, Tami. This is a great opportunity, and I'm delighted to be here with my former colleague, John Gartenberg. He and I shared many exciting moments together during our tenure, at both of our tenure at MoMA and then after. So I was a bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, recent art historian graduate and landed at MoMA. Let's see, now I'm going to share my screen so I can show you my PowerPoint. Oh, did I go too fast? I'm going to... Okay, Sharon, I need your coaching to get the audio. Oh, here it is. I see it. Share computer sound.
Sharon, at a mute.
Okay, I got it.
Okay, you got it? Great.
Yeah, and now I just have to go big. There, okay, great. So now I don't see you all, but here you see what I have on my laptop.
We see you and we see the presentation.
Okay, good. So I often start with this because I am from New York and my father's office was even in the Empire State Building and the tallest building then. And I'm a New Yorker, so New York was the center of my world. But I had a curiosity and a love, a wanderlust, so I love to travel. I love to start with this image of MoMA because of the little blurb here, art in our time. And that's something that the first director, Alfred Barr, was very committed to. How do you deal with a bureaucracy and deal with the recent past, the present, and how do you face the future? So as Sharon beautifully said, this book that came out in January, published by Fiden, is a kind of summation of my career. I couldn't put every artist I ever worked with in there, and that really pained me a lot because so many artists opened up their hearts and souls to me as I was curator investigating their work. COVID put an end on my book tour. So I thought I'm not going to sit on my hands. And that's when I came up with creating a podcast series. And many of the artists that I've interviewed in the podcast series, the 12th goes up actually in a week. And then there will be a bonus one. But some of them are not in the book. Because I really wanted to open it up. It's very international. So I had conversations with a few pioneers and a few up and coming. And they very openly, they were home during COVID, so they eagerly engaged with me. And the one final question that I ask each one of them is, do they consider themselves a media artist? I think 99% they said no, they are an artist. And I think that has to do with everybody present right now online. You're artists first and foremost, and it's your ideas that matter and how you approach the tools. The tools are not the be all end all. When I started and when John started a few years after me, we had very great excitement about the immediacy. We could have an image instantly through the Polaroid camera. We could have instant soup. We could have instant orange juice. We could have a telephone answering machine. Remember, this is pre-internet, pre-computer, personal computer. So when the portable camera came out in 1965, I just showed this because the camera itself weighed 20 pounds, the take-up reel weighed 20 pounds, and you had to thread up the video tape machine. Artists picked it up, those who could afford a $2,000 piece, an apparatus. So many shared what they purchased. They went in, pooled their resources. And one of the things they really first dealt with was what is now? How do you have a live image? What does that mean? And it was very philosophical in the questioning. So artists like the experimental filmmaker, Tony Conrad, who is also a musician, also a mathematician, very much engaged with, crossed over between the experimental film people and the experimental, we could call them video makers. So artists came from many different disciplines because video is brand new. So many came out of music, some came out of performance, which was emerging then. Many came out of trying to do something spatially where you really create an environmental work. So some who were very involved with music, like Joshua White did a light show for artists like Janis Joplin and many others. So I just show that because technology can be consumer, can be, you know, broadcast quality. And back then, TV stations closed their doors on anybody who was doing anything independent. So artists found their way and created alternative spaces. Some navigated into spaces like the Fillmore East, where Joshua White was doing these live experimental events. So technology, we didn't really hate technology then. We go through utopian moments where we love it, we're exploring with it, and then we hate it because those big, bad, awful people, the bureaucracy, they're either closing the airwaves to us or the manufacturers are limiting our tools. But we go through these flip-flops, and then this was a very euphoric moment when the US put a man on the moon. So then we thought, we can break all these boundaries, so let's do it. Someone like a David Bowie, before he was really, really hot, when he had emerged out of doing performance himself, then was becoming a rock star and did his song, Space Oddity, and he made a music video. So where would you show a music video in 1972? You show it in a bar on maybe a Scopatone apparatus. But here it is, the title, Space Oddity. It's referencing getting a man on the moon, but it's also various people were experimenting with drugs. So you could say perhaps it's also reference to drug trips. Artists who picked up video included Nam June Paik, who was very much experimenting with what is an object. And here he's got little garbagey type of things, an old shoe, a tin can, a key. And the idea was that you, the viewer, could come up and make it all clang and create a sound. Of course, now that's in a museum collection and you cannot touch it. All you can do is look at it. So the experience then becomes a video or a little clip next to the exhibited artwork so that you understand how it operates. Paik thought about television and the one-wayness of it. And in his studio wearing rubber boots, he would take out the insides or doctor them up so that he created with a magnet what we would call interactive TV before there was a name for it. And again, you can't touch that when it's in a museum collection, but you can see what the imagery would do if you move the magnet. So Paik was very much thinking about television and he was thinking about what was on television. So this is the Lindsay tape, is where he purloined a clip from the news of then Mayor John Lindsay. And he doctored it up. It's just a clip. And it's almost like a portrait of Lindsay with all of his hand gestures saying to a TV cameraman, okay, you can start recording. Okay, you can start recording. So I make this analogy to what Warhol was doing at the same time with taking pop icons like a Marilyn Monroe or an Elvis and making a silk screen and doctoring up the original image with very interesting colors and playing with the composition of this pop figure. 1970, a wonderful writer published the book called Expanded Cinema. And he was one of the first to really look at both experimental film and video and just describe and discover what the two fields were about. I won't go into this, and I don't know that John will go into this, but they were two different worlds. Some people overlapped, and they when there would be group meetings in New York about funding, it was almost like open warfare, because filmmakers thought video makers were going to take away all of the federal funding, and of course it didn't. Everybody got a piece of the pie. Paik, with one of the works, TV with Candle, was playing with what information is that normally would come from television. You have a warm, glowing image with that TV set that's really a box. So he took out all the innards, put in a candle, lit it, and is basically saying, like a memento mori, this is life. This is something more conceptual. So think about what is information, what is life, where do we get our knowledge? And we have a lot of knowledge. We have to acknowledge that. So I'll go quickly because I don't want to linger too much. I want to only spend an hour doing this so we can have a conversation. So an artist who picked up a camera early 1969 was Bruce Nauman. He was doing a lot of sculptural work out in California. He was in New York very, very briefly. He did not like New York City. He was out on the end of Long Island. And he made this video called Lip Sync. It's 60 minutes of him. The camera is recording him as if he's upside down. He's wearing big earmuff headphones, and he's trying to re-say exactly what he just said seconds ago. So he's hearing his voice in delay, and it's a very mesmerizing, hypnotic kind of image and experience if you watch it. When I taught first at NYU, I made my students watch the whole thing, and they went bonkers. But I said, this, you have to, with some works of art, you have to, and moving image work, you have to give yourself over to it, and you have to sit or be willing to let it get into you so that you're going to have an experience that will be different from your friend who might be standing or sitting right next to you. Because your experience is based on your knowledge and what you just saw. Nauman did a number of works where you, the visitor, physically experience his piece. This one, you walked down a corridor. There were two stacked monitors at the other end. And as you approached, you realized one image was of the empty corridor. The other one was live, and it was you going down the corridor, and it was the back of your head. So he's making you feel your physical body because it was a narrow space, and he's holding you captive, because normally if there's a camera on us, we're a narcissist and we want to preen. But here the camera's at the entrance to the corridor, you see the back of your head, never can you see your face. A big change happened in 1971 when Sony, Matsushita, and a number of other manufacturers put the 3/4-inch cassette on the consumer market. And that's what really allowed video art to take off. Artists could put their cassette in a Jiffy bag and mail it. It's when a number of distributors like Electronic Arts Intermix were founded by Howard Wise. So artists' work was then collected, and then museums and libraries could rent them or buy them. And can you believe it? The rent was probably no more than $20, if that, and then to buy it was $250. So these were, for acquisition, it's what we first got into MoMA, five of these unlimited edition works. So it was a very utopian moment. So this equipment was put in the closet, the dust bells, the dust accumulated on it. And then artists like Avito Acconci, who have been doing, as a poet, have been doing a lot of performance-oriented work. So then he's working with the camera in a very personal way, where he's trying to, in this video, remain centered in the camera. And this work, so it's a very beautiful early work by Joan Jonas. It's 1972. So those of you who are students, you're too young to remember or know about, early TV sets had a horrible flaw that the vertical hold would slip. So Joan was playing with that phenomenon and using the vertical hold as a rhythm for her very performative piece. I know in the audience is Hadassah Golvich, who was my former student, and I know she knows this piece very well. Another piece that is interesting, Chris Burden, the artist who sadly passed away a year or two ago, he actually bought advertising time on the LA TV station, the commercial one, not the PBS, and did a performance on the street of LA. So the visitor, if they were dial flipping, actually saw that live, and then on subsequent nights, they would see it as a video aired. So that's an example of commandeering what would not be normally accessible. And then this is Stane Vasulka, one of the co-founders of The Kitchen, the wonderful, venerable space in New York. And Stane was a trained violinist. Her husband, Woody, is a very great, he sadly passed quite recently, a tinkerer. And he tricked up her violin so that as she bowed, it manipulated the image. So a lot of artists were experimenting using the sound to doctor or do something to the image. Oh, there it is. So many of these are online, and that's what I encourage you students to do. We have a wealth of material through YouTube. So part of my practice was, as already Sharon, I think it was Sharon who said, MoMA was considered elite and not accessible. In 1975, I mentioned we acquired, MoMA acquired the first video artwork, Nam June, Joan Jonas, Bruce Nauman, Bill Wegman, Stane Vasulka. And then we very slowly acquired, and I think, I forget now if they're over, I think they're over 1,000 or more titles. But anyway, 2 years later, we launched Video Viewpoints, and that was my attempt to get artists uptown into—
Barbara, I'm sorry to disturb you, but I think we still hear it.
I don't know what to do.
Let me,
I'm gonna—
Maybe mute it.
I'm gonna—
Okay, maybe you can mute it. No, no, you see you have on the right—
I'm gonna delete it.
Okay.
I don't know how to, no, I don't know.
No?
Hey, Barbara, I'm sorry for interrupting. Maybe you can exit this slideshow and go to the next again.
Is it still sounding?
I think so.
Ah, shoot.
But you see on the right hand of the slider, there's a volume icon. I think you can press
okay.
It and take it down.
Ah, shoot.
Okay, here. Okay.
Did it stop? Okay. It's okay?
I think so.
Okay. Oh my gosh, I'll delete that. So anyway, it was an attempt to get artists. I had the grant from the Rockefeller Foundation. So every season I was able to invite an artist to come up, show their work and talk about it. It paralleled the film series called Cineprobe. I impressed on every artist to pay attention to what they said. because I was audio taping and we made transcripts. So I was always aware of the importance of archiving, even the ephemeral posters, postcards, bios, articles. All of that is now in the library. So it's a wealth of information. So it was part of my practice with video viewpoints to really think about what artists were saying, what they were doing. And this shows you the diversity, how I saw the field. It was very diverse. So you had someone like Stena, Vito Acconci, Bill Viola, who was quite young then, Beryl Corot, kind of documentarian, John Elpert. Someone who was very important in New York at that time, he'd come from California, I think now he lives in France and isn't so active. But here's somebody who went through the Vietnam War and was very much a protester and did a very interesting video about media. Nam June's TV Buddha, 1975, I put that into what we call our projects exhibition series. So I was always very pragmatic, trying to find ways to get my program, which had a very small budget, to place it in other programs which had bigger budgets. So this is Nam June's very important work, TV Buddha, where the classical Buddha is looking at a live image of himself on this futuristic TV set. So it's almost like a koan of what's the difference between a live image and a pre-recorded image. Because you only know the difference if you put your hand in front of the camera here. Bill Viola, interesting work he did at that point. I showed it at MoMA also. He works for you, what he called a tuned environment where everything was so carefully calibrated. He had a camera, a little drum. Under the drum was a microphone. Here is a drop slowly forming. The camera then shows the drop, and it's you, the viewer, upside down. So again, it's like a memento mori. The drop slowly forms and then falls onto the little drum. It makes the loudest boom you could ever imagine in the space. I got a grant of $5,000 from the Matsushita Corporation in 77, I think. And it got me to Japan. I stayed there 3 weeks. I ran around and met every video maker there was. And then I chose, I think about 20. This catalog is online on my website. It's now public domain. So I even published the catalog and worked with a wonderful designer on the cover. So identity politics have been big from the get-go. Of course, when video camera first came out in the mid-60s, we had a lot of political movements happening, of course, feminism. So one artist who's quite interesting lives in Toronto. Here's Lisa Steele in her work. She's stark naked when you see her in the beginning, and she shows and describes her autobiography behind every scar and defect on her body. So Martha Rossler, Semiotics of the Kitchen, if you haven't seen it, maybe it's in your library at the art school, but we had at that point, of course, a lot of French theory, semiotics. So Martha is playing on this heavy duty, heavy theory and cookery shows and women in the kitchen. So she starts with A, puts on apron, B, bowl, C, cup, and goes through the alphabet. I could do my mimic of Julia Child, but I won't. So often I do that. Anyway, another artist really important for the Bay Area and San Francisco, Lynn Hirschman has thought about technology for a long time. Also thinking about beauty, the whole notion of beauty and what the advertising world wants us as women, and now of course as men, to think about is how we should look. So here she did a piece, a kind of sculptural piece. She did a number of works that were performative and in video based on an alter ego, Roberta. She even got a driver's license for Roberta and a social security card. So sometimes artists are not dealt with the way they really should be. They're not written well into the history, but fortunately, in the last year, Lynn had a very major exhibition at a space in New York called The Shed. So sometimes it takes patience to, you know, if you're not considered a star in the beginning, it's a slow burn, keep at it. Another great artist who has worked with identity and female, how women are represented by the TV, television producers. So here, her technology transformation, what is she dealing with Wonder Woman. It's also a brilliant video. Another artist, lesser known, out of Zagreb, Sonja Vajkovic, in her very performative work, is just, you only see her torso, not her head, as she's holding makeup. So she's making herself up, making herself down. Annabella Geiger, another very interesting woman artist in Rio, in Brazil, working with the idea of map, and she's playing on the outline of Brazil. It's related to, in a way, the outline of the continent of Latin America. And the word, she plays with amulet, amuleta, amuleta, and it's quite a beautiful work. Another artist from Brazil, Sonia Andrade, also dealt with, in very horrific way, she's hammering nails between her fingers. And again, another feminist statement, another feminist, Mako Idemitsu, Another Day in the Life of a Housewife, a very early video for Japan. And here you've got, she was in Jungian analysis quite a while ago. So here you've got like an alter ego, and we've got, you know, what's going on in your head. So that, Haradina Pindell, another wonderful, important artist who didn't get her due early on and recently had a show at The Shed. And this is a very beautiful work, pre-white and black, Marlon Rigg. Is my video still playing? I hope not. Another artist, Marlon Riggs, just to show another approach, it's Marlon trained, did his graduate work as a journalist and did fantastic, amazing video and films. So working with the rap community. So mixed media, early on, I did this piece with Laurie Anderson, the Han Fum table, where the visitor walked in, put their elbows on the table, and through bone conduction, they heard Laurie really basically talking and singing. So rather than go on the road and do performance, Laurie created this object, which was in a way, you could say, performative. Joan Jonas, early on, I saw her performance at the anthology film archives. Then what happens with some of these performance pieces? So she would perform it for maybe 4 years. Normally, the performative work she did, she'd perform it for about 4 years and then put it in the closet. So fortunately, she decided to turn that into an installation, which MoMA acquired in around 2005. So the idea then, what is the work? What are the parameters? What's necessary? So I and the conservation department and the registrar spent many, many hours with Joan as to what exactly is the piece, what are the aesthetics. So all of the props are in the MoMA collection now. And we put it up, I think, around 2010. So MoMA is equipped to then put it up again. MTV appeared in 1981. It meant that artists like Laurie Anderson, then the music videos they were making, than had a venue. It was a very short open window for artists to make work collaborating. So I did a show in, I think, 1985, knowing that the music industry doesn't take care of its materials. So you can find that show on my website. It's called Music Video, The Industry and Its Fringes. I'm now scared to play this if it will then. So Pipiletti Reese, another artist who comes out of, in a way, performance and sculpture, turn to video and has done phenomenal installations. But I'm just going to play the audio very briefly. She's riffing on a Beatles song.
I'm not the girl who misses much, but bye-bye. I'm not the girl who misses much.
So the idea of Pipiletti being a very beautiful young woman, and she's revealing herself, not fully, as she's playing that like bird-like Donald Duck rendition of the Beatles song. So other artists are, were thinking about that security camera that would be in a bank or in a store. And she actually was, had a little business installing security into private individuals' homes. But then she created a persona and then created installations and performances. So Julia is quite an interesting artist. Gary Hill, someone like the Vasulkas, like Uviolo, really thought about what is image, what is sound. And this is an installation that I got into MoMA. I exhibited it in 1990, then a number of years later, we got it. But then what happens with the preservation of a work here, Gary took the raster out of the monitor. He took the teeny beany raster out of the Portapak camera, and he's playing on it a body part that's virtual size on that raster. He's elongated the wires that go back to what's called the chassis, which is underneath the shelf. The shelf is slightly lowered, so you almost have to bow to really look at it. So he's making you look at it according to what he wants. This is a nightmare of a piece for preservation. MoMA bought, I think, two or three backup rasters, because monitors are no longer made. MoMA has stockpiled, I think, 30 nice TVs for use of work. So MoMA.org, I with two colleague, curatorial colleagues, got MoMA to launch its pilot website. Actually, I was teaching at SVA then, and SVA hosted the initial site. But that's what allowed me to, I had a grant to go to China. It's what really facilitated my doing what I call curatorial dispatches. This is long before blogs. And I met with all 30 or so artists who were working with video. At that point, only one had a camera. No, only one had a computer. So it's up, you can go and access it. I was in Beijing, Shanghai, Hangzhou, and Guangzhou. And I met the amazing Zhang Pei Li, whose video we got into the collection, Hygiene Number 3. Back then, 91, there was rampant hepatitis. So here he's over and over, the same way Naumann repeated lip sync, Pei Li is washing this chicken, very unhappy. He survived the chicken. Cheryl Donegan, this is a younger generation than emerging. And I did a show with two colleagues. We curated it. It's called Head. So this younger generation of women, very in your face. So here's Cheryl drinking milk, spitting it out then on the wall behind her, and sucking more and spitting it. This is a very important composer, artist, Marina Rosenfeld. She's in my podcast. Sheer Frost Orchestra in 93. She actually did a PhD in music at Harvard and was so frustrated that it was a male place. No female, she was basically ignored. So when she got to CalArts and then pursued other studies, she created this composition for 17 women, each playing an electric guitar, and their choreographed actions, which she had them do, were made using only nail polish bottles. So she assumed this would only be a one-off. She's since been asked to repeat. So I hope these don't continue. Let me know if that sound continues. So, and I'm probably running out of time, so I'll move a little faster. So around 95 is when a number of companies put out very tiny projectors. Technology runs its course. It's one thing, it improves. The consumer market gets something and then it gets better. In the very beginning, projectors were horribly expensive. So nobody did projection in the late 60s. And the way you got mass was by piling up a bunch of monitors. Projectors then slowly became somewhat affordable for institutions in the mid to late 80s. But it was in 95 that these teeny ones were very cheap. I think they were like $300. So an artist like Tony Orsler took them, and he was working with narrative and then making single channel videos and doing installations with props. So then he took this projector and then started to work with these dolls, like calico fabric bodies and a white head. So then he could project onto the faces, project the faces on the heads. So then they're in here, it's like these two figures, they're nattering. It's like the id and the alter ego, and they're going, nah, 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 nah. So when these became like museum desirable objects, and many collectors bought them because finally you had an object that was diminutive. It didn't take up a whole space. It was not that complicated to install. It still took precision. You still needed it at a particular height, and you needed to adjust your projector just right. An artist, I think I've been in here twice for some reason. Anyway, out of my Japanese, I had two sabbaticals in Japan, and I spent a lot of time with Teiji Furuhashi and got to know a lot about Japanese aesthetics through him. So there's a lot of material on my website about him. He sadly died of AIDS a year after I put this into an exhibition. So I'm going to move on. I hope. Is it still clicking? So anyway, just to finish about Teiji. So that piece is extraordinary. It's haunting. It's a white linoleum on the floor, black walls, and the tower of equipment rotates like lazy Susans. And these figures move around the periphery of the room. And because the walls are black, they're very ghost-like. And they're very single. Occasionally, they'll come together in a virtual embrace. Occasionally, through a motion detector, the detection finds you. And Teiji stands there and falls back into the void. So it's very much about love in the time of AIDS. So yes. So I think I'll just go on. So I also got Nalini Milani into the MoMA collection, a really fantastic artist from India, from Mumbai. So game pieces, it's video with Hindu myths that she's painted, she's painted these mythic figures onto these mylar drums. She's got video of horror, war horror projected through. We got that into the collection, and it meant I worked very long and hard with her and our conservation team about what the paint is. I got her to use a more archivally sound polymer, Lexan. So these are things that as curators, we have to deal with if we're dealing with acquisitions. What is the work? What are the aesthetics? What are the tools? What happens if the technology upgrades? Then what are the core aesthetics of a piece? And that means you've got to have floor plan, diagrams, electrical schematics. You've got to have an interview with the artist to really nail down what those aesthetics are. And if they've passed, then you have to go to the widow, the widower, the assistant, and just do your best. Because you don't want to bollocks it up. Koi Archangel, wonderful artist who early on was taking consumer games and hacking them. And then here he's got Mario pinioned onto one little cube. And all Mario can do is move his head. I did a big show with my last show at MoMA, and it's called Soundings, a Contemporary Score. And in there, I did a lot of research. It took me several years worth of research to select the artists, spent a lot of time designing the overall installation because, as you know, sound travels. It's just it's a terror, so you have to be very careful. So anyway, Camille Norman, Trip Light, it's a silent piece where it's an old microphone that's been taken apart and the light is put inside and it pulsates. So it's like the breathing, the heartbeat. So you get the feeling of the intimacy of someone like a Billie Holiday if they were singing at the microphone. And then what do you do with a work that's just an empty room and you barely can see the 16 speakers? And this is something that Jana Winderen made. Where you're in the space and it's as if when this cycle, which is about 18 minutes, starts, you're underwater, you hear underwater sounds, then you hear the sound at the level of the surface of the water. You may hear a boat oar going in, and then you're up, and then you may hear sounds, and they're actually the sounds that bats make when they're out at night. It's their echolation, and normally it's inaudible, and she took that sound down to a pitch that you can hear. I'm gonna go really fast now. Sandra Perry, someone was also really thinking about gaming, about identity. She's a very solid artist who is from New Jersey and did her master's at Columbia. Rachel Rosen, DR is all in the news, and I'm sure some of you are doing great work with VR. It's a new technology, so I think we have maybe a little bit of time before we're really going to work out the aesthetics. But Rachel is someone who started programming with a very simple computer her mother gave her when she was like 8, and she was painting. And then in Florida, where she's from, where the weather is really disastrous, we have hurricanes, they have hurricanes and everything. So she created this work for the Zabolodowicz collection. The Zabolodowicz family is very generous. Maybe some of you know them. Once they're interested in an artist, they really help to support the work. So this work was realized because of the family, and it was shown in 2019. So basically what the viewer does, they enter into the room. And if you're lucky, if one of the headsets is not occupied, you become almost the cursor, and it's you moving through and affecting the imagery So you're in the space, and it's almost like a kaleidoscope. Behind this wall, these slits, then there's other things that happen. So here you see Florida. So what do we do now? We've got another lockdown. And as Sharon mentioned, I organized this show, which should have opened in San Francisco in April. So now, fingers crossed, it can open in February. We're not sure. We're waiting on bated breath, I guess you could say. But I chose artists who were not in my soundings show. So Ian Forsyth and Jane Pollard are in my, my Barbara London Calling podcast. So is Bonnie Hightel, a really interesting artist from Singapore. And Samson Young from Hong Kong. Juan Cortez from Bogota. Marina Rosenfeld, whose work I showed you early on with the female orchestra in the nail polish bottles. So this is in my Seeing Sound show, Her Music Stands. She is still an artist in residence at Nokia Bell Labs, whatever that means now, because Nokia Bell Labs is closed to anybody who's not an employee. But the engineer from Bell Labs has been going to Marina's studio. So sometimes things work out. I could show you a little bit so you. So what happens is you, the viewer, walk around. There are these dangling microphones. It picks up ambient sound. And then occasionally there's actually her voice, or you hear kind of words happening. Yuko Mori, her sound sculpture, Voluta, which twirls. So where do we go from here? I hope in 2021, I am able to do a second series. I'll have to raise the money. I hope an artist like Paul Pfeiffer, who's in the current podcast series, gets to do more great work. This was phenomenally costly to do. He spent 2 years at the University of Georgia with the Redcoat Band. And it's a very complicated political piece because the band is what drives the audience during a football game. And the orchestra is all white. The football players usually are all black. So he's going to continue. This was performed with the band on screen. It's live in Georgia, parts of the band, then on stage in the Apollo for the performance that happened on November 11th. So I hope that he's able to take that a little further. This is an artist who is fantastic from Nigeria. She lives in LA now. Here she's worked with people from her community in Oguni land in Nigeria. And this gentleman is having a meal, and it's as if you're sharing the meal with him. So he takes the cup and drinks, he slurps that fish on the plate, and he trusted her, she trusted him, and I could go on about how it was recorded, how virtual reality is handled. Chafe spent 2 years working on this particular piece. This building is an old film theater in a former factory area in Beijing called 798, and it's been her studio in the last year or two. So it's a very complicated story about this. The factory actually made the earliest computers in China. So the whole story of the past from the 50s and then the present. Kilgill Joseph, another artist who's quite fascinating to me. He's taken television news and he's showing it on two flat screens that's on a wall of showing these nuns. So it's about culture, life, race, how groups are revealed and shown on in the news. Wang Mo Wen, I'm just gonna go on. So I found this online, Sharon's work that was in New York. Sometimes we commandeer unusual spaces, or we commandeer something with the help of some others. So here in Times Square is an area where artwork has been put up on the billboards. This is someone I don't really have time to go into, but Claudia Hart has done really interesting work where you would walk in and it's very interactive. And then using the Mozilla hubs, you enter into the space. So that's it.
Thank you very much.
I'm afraid I had to go so fast, so.
Thank you so much. And Barbara, we would like to open now for questions. Please sip your coffee or something and to kind of, you know.
Okay, I'm gonna go get my coffee. My coffee right, in the other room.
So we have now time for a Q&A. Waiting for Barbara to come back. So Efrat Shalem is a professor in our department and an artist herself. So please, Efrat, go on and your mic.
Hey, first I would like to say that I'm very excited to have you here with us today. And I would like to thank you all, and of course to Tami and to Sharon for this amazing event. And now to my question. In 1977, David Bowie released his album Low, and the fourth song in the record entitled Sound and Vision begins with a question, don't you wonder sometimes about sound and vision? I would like to ask you about your visionary curatorial decision to show sound in a museum space as early as in the 1970s. Your decision brought David Bowie's wonder of sound and vision to the visual arts. In these times in which we are being relentlessly bombarded by images and sounds from morning to night, my question is, are we still wondering about sound and vision, or are we defending ourselves from it?
Oh, my. Well, I think sound and vision or sound and image are, it's a huge world. When I wanted first to do a sound show at MoMA in the late 70s, MoMA said no. You know, like any institution, you go through checks and balances. So MoMA is a very visual place. And now that's changed. It took a long time. But I was organizing basically video shows in a small gallery. And I decided, since my big idea was nixed, you know, it was not approved, I would do a small one. So I actually did a sound show in, I think it was 1980, and I put three artists in it. So it was the gallery. I always had to let the institution know what I was doing. I did that, and that was normal. Image and sound are together in cinema. MoMA has, I forget how many now, probably 20,000 films. An enormous number. That was the film collection was founded in 1935. Video program was founded around 1974. The collection started 75. I then did the music video industry and its fringes in 85, interested in how artists were collaborating. I was very interested in collaboration. I didn't want to include work in that show where it was an artist who just illustrated a music work. But I was interested in true collaboration. So that's what I'm interested in. And indeed now, as the world changes and continues to change, we've got images everywhere. We've got images, you know, on billboards, if we have our shops any longer, we have images in the store windows. We have it on our subways. We have it everywhere, and we're hardened to it. I think all of us as artists or as curators or John doing what he's doing, we are really committed to the vision of these poets, really. I consider artists to be poets, and I'm very grateful that they open up to me or they share. And we're always gonna have the commercial or the boring, to me, maybe it's boring, but you know, I'm interested in something that takes me somewhere, moves me, hits my soul in some way. So I don't know if that answers you.
It is. Thanks much.
Sharon, you're muted, we can't hear you.
Thank you. Just if someone wants to ask a question, just shout out because it's a huge grid. David, I see you. So yeah, sure. David, fourth year student, yes.
Hi, Barbara, very nice to meet you. Thank you for coming today, it's awesome. So I actually, when we started or we opened this discussion, I think it was John who mentioned that we're staying away from, or in Israel and in America, this idea of staying away from this political or this political discussion. But we did see at least one example of some sort of art form that was speaking towards some sort of political thing, which was throughout the 60s and 70s. And I'm curious to know, as someone who's like witnessed these changes throughout the time, and these days as an artist, like what kind of influence we can have actually trying to engage the public with these political opinions or whatnot, and how come we're refraining from these things or these topics nowadays?
Well, I think there are a lot of organizations very committed to this, and I think big institutions like a MOMA have been changing, and they're very aware that they have to open up to many different points of views, that it's not the old linear story of art history, but it's very complex, the story. And of course, the present is always complex, and it's complex to wade through what's being done. And then how you as artists, you take some of it in your own hands or with a collective, or because I see there's a statement can be made by grouping together, and maybe somehow you do a show somewhere, you get a friend who's a journalist, or you know someone who's going to write about it. You do a blog, you put your work in there. You know, we have all of these other tools now.
So like our strength is in numbers in the sort of a collective form, you would say.
I think that's how in the early days, you know, these what we called alternative spaces, that's where work was shown. And it was because in New York, what I know the best, but I know it was in England and I know it was in Tokyo too. But if the city is bankrupt, spaces are cheap. And I think we're going to see that in New York. The city is bankrupt. Subway can barely run now. So I think, you know, there will be now activity coming from underground. And I think some of it is happening online. You know, there are very angry people. Whether that was the recent election, you know, there are very angry people. My country is divided now. And I don't like that, but that's the way it is. And I think I, as someone who still curates or writes and teaches sometimes, this is what I tried to do as a curator at MoMA, was to be aware And one of my colleagues said, oh, you're very Catholic, not meaning I'm religious, but I'm trying to have a broad view. And I just hope then you can influence and have an impact on those with a broad view who will give you the window.
Yeah.
I want to tap into this, David, question. You were saying in the book that talking about it, a show by in the 70s by conceptual art, you were saying that the technologies were globalizing and democratizing power. Do you still feel that? And I think it's in relation to David's question, is still technology, it's a globalizing and democratizing power, democracy question here.
Well, I think so. I think with the internet, as long as Google doesn't, this is where I think our, you know, if what I know is the U.S. I know that the news keeps certain information off, okay, and I know that Google kills certain searches. Mm-hmm. So as long as we continue to have information open, you know. So I think.
Just to close on that, Barbara.
Wait a minute, David. John wanted to ask a question.
Yeah, I wanted to clarify, David, that when I said steering clear of politics, what I meant is that keeping the US politics and the Israeli politics out of this discussion, but I did not at all mean anything about films that I acquired at MoMA, which I'll go into later, were not political. What I meant is, for example, that I talked to one of my cousins who's a conspiracy theorist, and I was shocked because I'm very close to her. So I didn't want to go into all that because I think then that devolves into a discussion of, you know, who supports whom and all that. But just as an example, for example, when I acquired films at MoMA, which I'll go into later, and then I did an exhibition in 1979, one of the categories I did was social and political documentaries from 1972. So I acquired three films. One was The Liberal War by Nick McDonald, which was about attacking, the war in Vietnam. Another one was Red Squad by the Pacific Street Film Collective, which was about how the police were spying on the left wing in activists in New York. And the third one, which was very important, was Joyce at 34 by Joyce Chopra and Claudia Weil, who both went into Hollywood. And it was about the difficulty of being a mother and being pregnant and a mother and also being a filmmaker in the role of women. So I did not at all mean, because I'm personally also very politically engaged, that one should avoid it. I mean, I'm like Barbara, I think, very open about all of the different threads and themes and issues that the artists raise. And I felt like that was something very important as a sort of aspect of some of the experimental filmmakers, that some of them are very politically engaged and they express that in their films.
Okay. Thanks, John.
Thanks
more questions? Yes, Dawn.
Yes, I have a question.
Just a second, Dawn, here. A second, Hila. Okay. Dawn and then Hila, okay? Mm-hmm. Okay.
So my question is this. I always looked at art as something that can exhibit sociological phenomena in quite a clear and beautiful way. And I also believe that if you look at something for quite a while, you can start to understand patterns in your data set and to recognize some meaning in some pattern. My question is whether you see, or what kind of patterns do you see in contemporary works, and what kind of contemporary trends show us about our state of our societies?
Wait, show us what?
What they show us about the state of our societies and our beings.
Oh, I think there's actually a lot of work being done addressing that. The only problem with the here and now is there's a lot of it, and how to get through, how to find it. But I know it's there, And I know, you know, just to say a little thing about the patterns in meaning, I'm a very different generation from you. And your codes, what you have, maybe somewhat different. So I'm always struggling to figure out, I don't know, something went off, I don't know. Always struggling to figure out what am I missing, or what, you know, what am I missing? So then it takes me asking, looking. But there's, anyway, yeah. I hope that answers you somewhat.
I'd like just a bit more if, like, what kind, you're searching, so you're searching for those patterns and what are you finding? How do these patterns look? What are the things which pop up in relation to everything else?
Oh, this is hard because it's so big. I mean, it's easy for me to say to you the moving image is all about narrative, but narrative in a very abstract, it can be pushed and turned, and it's not like Hollywood narrative. And work isn't just linear. Now we have, like what Claudia Hart did, we have all of these tools. Now it's interactive. Now you can enter in, you can have an avatar, you can engage, you can do something very social in her work. You can communicate with someone. Mozilla now is more accessible. So what can I say? I'm indeed curious about all of these things. I'm curious about VR. Not all of VR moves me, because I think too much is about exploring what the tools are. So I want to see how the tools can be used for deeper meaning. And the deeper meaning could be political, could be visual, could be, you know, personal. But of course, if it's too personal, then it's too personal. You know, so how do you find the line there where then it's open to others' experience, not just you? So all of these are complicated.
Okay, thank you.
I appreciate your question.
Thank you very much.
I see people wanting to ask questions. I said Hila, and then Ira Pereg will ask, and Liron, I saw you. Hila?
Yes, hi. In this context, I would like to know what your opinion about the selection process of the MoMA in the artist work, in consideration of not just the technological changes, but also this wide range of platforms, art and cultural changes has been taking part of. And it's not just galleries or biennales now, it's much wider. And how does this process has been reestablished?
That's a very complicated process, acquisition and exhibition. And throughout the museum's history, there are checks and balances. And there have been, up until very recently, curatorial departments that really handle a medium. So you've got photography, you've got prints and illustrated books and drawings, you've got painting and sculpture, and you've got film, and then you've got media and performance art. So when I started, the big titans was the Department of Painting and Sculpture. They had the most money, they had the biggest staff. And then next to that was film. And to a lot of the other curators, that was the great unwashed, because the audience in the theater was, you know, gradually everything. And there was also architecture and design. And so they were, the curators in those departments understood the history, understood the aesthetics. What's happened more recently, all the while, artists have been crisscrossing. somebody might be a painter and I would get annoyed that Richard Serra was also doing film, was also doing drawing, was also doing video, but nobody talked together. Finally now everybody talks together and everybody now talks about what are the gaps in what we collect, what they, it's not me anymore, what they collected in the past and how to catch up. And of course, to acquire, you need money. So you have to go to the trustees or you have to go to a collector and try to get them to donate a work. But even if someone donates, it's very carefully scrutinized because it costs money to preserve something, to put it in the storeroom. Even so, then artists would become very annoyed if I got a work in and it wasn't shown. Well, there were so many works and the real estate in the gallery is competitive, you know, so you're doing exhibitions and you've got to compete with everybody else for the floor space. And then you've got to compete for the money for me to do the soundproofing, to build the walls, that costs. And that cost is in the budget of the show. So then, you know, so it's all, it's a complicated process, but at least I have to say, what Glenn Lowry has done in the last couple of years is he's really opened it up. Glenn is the director. He's really opened it up to much more dialogue among the different curatorial departments. So if you were to go to MoMA now, you would see the contemporary collection, and it's really, you know, there might be a photograph, there might be a drawing, there might be a sculpture, there might be something industrial even, or a film projected. Now projectors are have such great luminance that you don't need a black box for all of these projected works. So all of these things are changes, and it took time for an institution like MoMA to adapt and kind of expand its thinking. I hope that answers.
So we will take just two more questions, short questions, and then we will take a break and we will have more time at the end of the panel, okay? So Nira Pereg, an artist that you mentioned in her name in your book when you talk about collections. So here's Nira.
Hi. Thank you, Sharon, and thank you, Barbara, for the beautiful lecture. It was really interesting to go through the works that you mentioned, realizing how much they have to do with space, how much they had to do in installation, apropos your answer now about the expensive real estate and the generosity that you gave for the medium in order to be experienced in this spatial way. And I'm just, you know, if we're noticing now the highly budgeted new productions of video art, which are very much film-like, even, one can say, in terms of budget and in terms of even viewing experience. And you haven't kind of included these kind of works in the short retrospective that we've seen. And I'm just wondering what you think of this new trend or new kind of development of video art into a more even cinematic kind of position, which doesn't require all this spatial involvement or bodily involvement of the viewer or this kind of multi-channel.
I think it's I think it's a very interesting, very exciting area because it's, as you say, it's one projection, but yet it needs sound, so it needs, that needs to be thought of very carefully, and there are the people who have in the West, like Isaac Julian, you know, he made a name for himself almost more than his experimental film, these installations now. So, yeah, and you could put Jill Viola in that category, you know, I won't say what I was gonna say, but some of that work, which is very painterly, then that is loved by museum directors because they can relate. You know, it's time-based, but it's very painterly, it's very visual, and very beautiful. But it's much more than that. So, and I truly appreciate how costly it is to make some of these works. If you want to do more than just go out and shoot the editing sound, or you need a crew, or you need it's very complicated. And I just wish there were more venues or more collectors in the US. I don't know about in Israel, but the collectors, Pam and Dick Kramlich, you know, they've really, they could have, with their money, he's a hedge fund person. They could have bought one Jackson Pollock, but instead they bought, I don't know, they've now acquired, I don't know, 80, you know, video pieces. And I think they continue maybe to acquire. So, and there's a woman in Munich, Jenny Gertz, who also acquires or has acquired a lot of video. And I just, I'm grateful that they're out there in the world. And I'm just gonna give you a funny anecdote. I had a conversation with Jenny Gertz, Ingevold Gertz is her full name, a year or two ago. And I was asking her about her collecting and why she gave the bulk of her collection to the museum in Munich, one of them. And she said, well, they didn't do anything. And I was so annoyed that they never bought video. I gave them my collection, you know. So now it's in a public collection. And then I said, well, are you continuing to acquire? She said, yes, it's what drives my soul. What young people are doing. So as long as we have people like that, then your work and your colleagues and I have hope. And then I hope that it gets written about and then the information is shared. And that's what our being together today is about. You know, I'm very interested in learning.
So one short question, the last question before we take a break by Liron, second year student, and we will have more time at the end of the panel, okay?
Okay, thanks. Thank you, Barbara, for being here. I just have a quick question about your perspective of the idea of your responsibility as curators of giving stage to specific narratives, and how do you see it? Do you feel like you have the responsibility to show as many points of view as you can, or are you maybe feeling like, do you feel like anyone deserves a stage or only specific people deserve the stage? And how do you see this whole topic?
Well, it's a very difficult position. If, say, as I worked at MoMA in those early decades, you know, I had a space and I was lucky I could, you know, select and program, and I would raise money to acquire work, whatever. And I said, I used the word Catholic, but I meant, I really wanted to show the diversity. I really wanted to include as much as possible, but yet there were limitations. There were money limitations still, or there were, you know, there are too many of you out there to like put everybody in. So, and then I also had to understand what my blinders were. And my blinders, we all have blinders. So then I would, that's where, like one of your colleagues asked a relevant question. I had to then really go and investigate and understand why I didn't understand it. And what was I missing? So those are important things. So, and then people would ask me, why aren't you showing me? This was, you know, in the first 10 or 20 years, why aren't you showing me? And I would say, you know, I can't show everybody. And then I would say, we are one institution. And at least in New York, there's the Whitney, there's the Guggenheim, there's the Kitchen, there's, so, you know, you have other platforms. So we just try to do our best.
Okay, so I think that Barbara deserves a small recess, and we all do. So we will join in 10 minutes. 13 minutes and 3:50. So stay with us, and we will welcome John when we return, and then following we will have the panel. So, and everyone who has questions, I hope we have more time for that in the after the panel. So see you in 10, 13 minutes.
So we're back. I would like to present John. This is a great honor for us, John, to have you with us. John Gartenberg is a film archivist, distributor, programmer, and curator, president of the Gartenberg Media Company for Experimental Cinema Distribution. While working for nearly two decades as a curator in the Museum of Modern Arts Department of Film. He acquired numerous avant-garde films for the permanent collection. His signature projects include restoring the films of Andy Warhol and editing and publishing catalog of MoMA Archival Film Collection. John has also authored many articles on film history and on preservation, including The Fragile Emulsion, published in several publications, and we sent the beautiful piece to our students in the previous days, the past days. And John asked me to start his talk with a great transition from Barbara's talk, with showing a clip from the filmmaker Warren Sonberg, which John will address in his talk. It's a film called Where Did Our Love Go? From 1966, and I'm going to show a short clip. It's a short clip filmed in MoMA and the MoMA galleries. Please, everyone, if you can mute. Okay, so I'm sharing the screen. I'm showing the showing from my computer. Where did our love go? So please have a warm welcome to John Gartenberg.
Thank you, Sharon. So I wanted to thank Sharon, the head of the department, also Vivian Ostrovsky, because Sharon said that Vivian had recommended when she come to New York to meet me, and we met in the restaurant attached to the Film Society of Lincoln Center, and we started chatting, and Sharon was very interested in the history of video, but also the history of film, because they're moving image works and time-based, but they have really kind of different histories and origins. And she thought it would be a good idea to bring this discussion together, which I think is a great idea, because in my mind, it's not always fully discussed. And just as an aside, like when I go to galleries and see video art projected, sometimes I look at the wall labels and I think, oh, but that issue that they're raising in the wall label, like it's been in a experimental film world like 30 or 40 years ago. And so I think sometimes there isn't enough interactivity for both the experimental film world and experimental video world to really converse about their histories. So I'm gonna basically go over a number of things. I'm gonna touch upon topics. I'm not going to necessarily go into real depth. I'm going to tell some also funny anecdotes. My goal in this is because it's paying homage to Barbara and her wonderful work, her book, and knowing her from about 1973 or 74. So I'm going to kind of try to talk with this to anchor my discussion and what she talked about. For example, that clip that you just saw from Warren Sonberg's Where Did Our Love Go is from 1966. And I wanted to show that because he was an experimental filmmaker and a student at NYU who started making films in that year. And it relates to Barbara, where she was talking about, what was it, Barbara, in 65, it was the video cameras that became available. So just to give you an idea of picking something sort of contemporaneous to what Barbara talked about, I think is a good sort of anchor point. So I also, that clip was from Where Did Our Love Go? And that's a walk through MoMA's galleries. He used his friends and students at NYU. And I thought that would be a great starting point since Barbara and I both worked at MoMA. And that's just a few years before we started there. And the first thing I wanna really touch upon is what Barbara was dealing with, because I think it's a kinship we've talked about. When Barbara talked about feeding the soul, and this is where I get a little emotional, because sometimes now I think that curators, it's all become like kind of a job. Sometimes it's not rigorous. It's kind of put something on the screen or acquire something, but not really being rigorous with themselves about what they're doing and why they're doing it. And I think Barbara and I both share that kind of idea. We don't approach these things casually as like from an egotistical point of view. We're approaching it from a point of view of sort of deference to the artists and trying to understand what's going on. My experience of this also was how these filmmakers really touch my soul and inspire me. And one of the experiences I had after MoMA was programming experimental films for the Tribeca Film Festival, which was started by Robert De Niro. And it was kind of subversive because I had my own sort of perch to show these films, and they would be either established filmmakers or young filmmakers, but there was something about these films that just deeply moved me and deeply touched me. And the other thing I would say is I'm not a filmmaker. I made films at Cornell University in undergrad, and I archived them away because they were so terrible. But I think that that gave me some kind of at least objectivity in the sense of certain filmmakers are also involved in certain institutions. And I think sometimes it's not, it's a critique, not a criticism, but sometimes, you know, their own desire for their own films to be highlighted can sometimes, have an effect on how they approach what they do. And the other thing I wanted to say about Barbara is a couple of experiences. One is that when I started at MoMA, my first job was to catalog films in the collection, and that was at age 21. And what's more exciting than getting paid to watch movies? But I remember very distinctly, like the first time I met Barbara, since I was cataloging and Barbara was pioneering, setting up the video department in MoMA. And the cataloging at that point was being added to MoMA's collection. And I remember going to Barbara's office, and I remember Vertical Roll, which was one of the acquisitions, and we talked about cataloging it. The other thing I wanted to say about Barbara was the other thing that she would do sometimes, because MoMA ended at 5:30, and I remember we did numerous things. She'd say, John, do you want to go around town? And she had a whole thing mapped out. So we'd start at the American Federation of Arts, and we'd go to a holiday party there. And then she said, oh, I know there's this artist that's doing something in a loft space, let's go there. And then there was a third or fourth place to go. And so by midnight, we had visited four places. And it was really fun to do it with Barbara. But also, the other thing I wanted to convey is this was a time that was very exciting. And I think Barbara's conveyed it in a way, she was very pioneering in what she was doing in this institution. And it required also, as I felt in my dealing with experimental films, you have to be a little bit subversive. I mean, my subversive aspect was more at the Tribeca Film Festival, which was completely commercial, but that for 11 or 12 years, I could show experimental works. So there's something about taking on the ethos of these filmmakers or video artists who don't fit easily into certain molds. Yes, they're artists, and yes, they've worked in other media, but there's something about the form which sort of cuts against the standard commercial grain. To go to experimental film, at age 23, when I was 23 years old, MoMA got a $33,000 grant from the Jerome Foundation for experimental films to be acquired for the collection. To explain also, Barbara was a one-person show within the film department for video. When I was in the film department, at that point, it was very divided. And I don't mean divided antagonistically divided, but there was a curator of programming who was Adrian Mancha, and there was a curator of the archive who was Eileen Bowser. So I worked in the archive department. I ended up doing exhibitions, but my basic focus was on the archival aspects of film work, which has to do with collection and preservation, and is a very different practice, although related to film programming. Also, I was a curatorial assistant then, and I had pretty much free rein to acquire the experimental films for the permanent collection, which would never happen today. I mean, a curatorial assistant helps the curators, but at that point, I was able, my boss who was the curator, looked over my shoulder, but I basically had a lot of free rein. But I took the job very seriously because most of these films, as some of you may know at that point, were made by filmmakers on, and it had to do with the economy of shooting and developing the film, were made on 16 millimeter reversal. But I was acquiring films for the permanent collection. of MoMA. There were other films that were for 16 millimeter that were for the circulation collection or for the study collection. So I felt that my mission was serious in the sense that I had to think about what was the tradition of the MoMA and what was the tradition of experimental film at MoMA. So basically the grant was given to, Barbara mentioned, like there was CineProbe, which started in the 60s to acquire films of filmmakers that were shown in CineProbe. And then I expanded that out. But to do that, I did extensive research. I read through, and here's the difference where Barbara was dealing with video art that was just emerging. I had to deal with like decades and decades of film history beforehand. So to look at like what the gaps were in the past, but also stay abreast with the present. So I did research going back to Iris Barry, who was the first curator of the film department in 1935, reading the MoMA bulletins, Richard Griffith, who was a curator, who wrote an article in 1956, where he talked about experimental film. Then Willard Van Dyke took over and I started with working with him, and he was a filmmaker and the head of the department and also was a supporter of experimental film. So I really wanted to understand the tradition into which I was working. And one of the first acquisitions at MoMA was Ballet Mécanique, which is the Fernand Léger film. And so the tradition that I was dealing with was modern art, which deals with the issues of time and space and the representation of it. And I wanted to kind of carry on that tradition. And in doing my research, of course, I found that European avant-garde films were shown in San Francisco. Sidney Peterson was involved, and there were some other filmmakers. And so I wanted to kind of put some shape onto what I was acquiring. And I realized that there were very few or almost no Sidney Peterson films, nor James Broughton, who worked with Peterson on a couple of movies. So sort of the anchor of the collection was acquiring Sidney Peterson and James Broughton films, like I think it was four of each of theirs. And then expanding into that, looking at other filmmakers' works who had not been necessarily acquired, which included like Jonas Mekas. There were some Stan Brakhage, but an increasing more of Stan Brakhage and a lot of other filmmakers, because I was looking primarily at the post-war period, which of course is abstract expressionism. So in a way, in the MoMA context, it was like, how were these experimental filmmakers dealing with abstraction? And that started my journey. I also looked at the MoMA information show in 1970, when there were prints of Ernie Gier and a few prints of Ken Jacobs, but I expanded the collection of Ernie Gier films, for example. The other formative experience for me was I took at NYU P. Adam Sitney's class. P. Adam Sitney is one of the great theoreticians of the avant-garde. This is one book he wrote, which is called Eyes Upside Down. And he actually, it's not upside down. He actually did a chapter on Warren Sombert after I did a show of Warren Sombert films at the Guggenheim, which was fascinating for me because there were other revelations that he had about Sombert based on the exhibition there. And he really taught experimental film. There's the structural tradition, there's the mythopoeic tradition. And I think this addresses maybe what one of the people had mentioned earlier on. I didn't take that kind of approach. I was much more open to kind of looking at the works and seeing what was represented in them. So for example, in acquiring a number of films, there was the social and political documentaries from 1972. I wasn't putting it in this larger categories that Sitney did, but I was looking at the work and seeing what were themes or ideas that were emerging. Another example is I did a contemplation of the photographs by putting a film by Michael Snow, 1 Second in Montreal, together with acquiring Hollis Frampton's Nostalgia, because they were both dealing with still images, but in very different ways. So I was always trying to look at like what was emerging as I was seeing these films and how to maybe put them together to when I was programming to compare and contrast them. Then what happened is I began to expand to other filmmakers. I primarily started with France, acquired films by for example, Jan Bové, and I mentioned Vivian Ostrovsky. The other thing that then happened, because I worked at MoMA for 18 years, is I realized that I was acquiring these reversal prints, but what about the camera originals? So I began to acquire camera originals of films by Warren Sombert, short films by Mark Rapaport. I didn't get to do much preservation on those because at that point I left MoMA. But the other big project I worked on was conserving Andy Warhol's films. And that was another big project. So basically, to condense my talk more, my projects were dealing with the acquisition, preservation of the films. And of course I did programming. And when I left MoMA, I continued doing that. And I wrote this article called The Fragile Emotion, which I recommend you read because one of the main tenets of it is that the approach to preserving experimental films to me has to do with understanding the artist's process, how the artists work in terms of making the preservation decisions. And as distinct from like experimental film artists could often deal with multiple versions of the same film, like Sombert made three versions of Carriage Trade. And that's in opposition or contradistinction to the commercial cinema where everything is fixed in a form to be mass distributed. So I will just focus on Sombert here because my time is limited. But the other reason why I'm bringing up Warren Sombert is because Barbara was talking about how these artists are not limited to one area. Like he was considered an experimental filmmaker, but he was also an opera critic. He wrote a full-length opera to Capriccio. He also had an influence on experimental poets. When I showed his films in Philadelphia, a couple of experimental poets came, and it was very poignant because they said the thing they were envious about Warren Sombert was that, people had to read poetry from left to right, but Sombert could turn the image upside down. You know, he could do all sorts of things. And it's really fascinating to get the insight when you have artists from other fields like language to talk about an experimental filmmaker and how they read into all of that. The other thing about Sombert is he dealt with the art world. He photographed in Where Did Our Love Go? For example, there's scenes in Warhol's factory. There's a art show of Tom Wesselman's work that he shot also in the Castelli and Janus galleries. He shot at the Bleecker Street Cinema. In Hall of Mirrors, he filmed Gerard Malanga, who was a Warhol superstar, in Lucas Samaras's mirrored room sculpture. So it's just to say that Sombert was also anchored in the arts, which I think was part of Barbara's point. It's not necessarily that the experimental filmmakers were all in their own ivory tower, even though they could work independently and make their films as Sombert did independently. He was still surrounded and influenced by this whole art world. So I think my time is getting near the end. Is that right, Sharon? I have a couple of minutes. Yeah. So I think what I want to do now is, and I'll just add one thing, is to show a clip. A trailer that my colleague who works with me, Fred Rydell, put together, who also is involved with the art world, worked at the American Federation of Arts, and he collaborates with our company now. There's clips from three films by Warren Sombert, Amphetamine, Where Did Our Love Go, and Hall of Mirrors. And also you can see these films online if you go to my company's website, www.gartenbergmedia.com. We've just set up a new section of the website called streaming, because in my career, I thought I'd never have to go from celluloid to digital, which I did, to DVD. And I thought, oh my God, now I have to learn about streaming and go into streaming. But this is the launch of our streaming site. And you can see those three films in their entirety. And I'd also say in relationship what Barbara said about COVID, it's interesting because one of the films, Where Did Our Love Go, which you'll see is in all of these art gallery setting, and it's a lot of people together. Then you're gonna see a clip from Hall of Mirrors, which is another Warhol superstar, Rene Ricard, and he's alone with this pop soundtrack and with a flower, it's a lost love. So he's kind of like the isolation of COVID. And then the last clip you're gonna see is from Amphetamine, which is Sondberg's first film, which is all about sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And you're going to see a scene of two boys kissing. This is directly an homage to Alfred Hitchcock's Vertigo, because Sondberg was seeing films when he was a teenager. When he was a teenager, he published articles on an interview with Jean-Luc Godard. He published an article on Alfred Hitchcock, and he had a career retrospective by the time he was 20. And Variety, the newspaper of the commercial cinema, said not since Andy Warhol's Chelsea Girls has there been such an event with such a buzz around it. So what's been exciting for me is to excavate now. This is just his first three works. They're not what he's really known for. He's known for his silent montage films, but this is part of the joy of and the challenge of being a curator, is to really dig and dig deep into work and discover things and try to expose them. So now, Sharon, I think if you can show the film, and that'll be
the end. Show it. And if you can put the link to your streaming site on the chat, it would be amazing. If not, I will distribute it later to the students. Okay, so I'm sharing the screen.
Okay.
It's a 3-minute clip.
I've waited so long for your kisses and your love. Please come to me from up above.
Come softly, darling. Come softly.
I need you so much. On a field, you won't touch me. Dum 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 do dum 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 do dum 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 do dum 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 dum.
That's it.
That was the clip. Is it missing the last part?
Well, those are clips from the three films. I mean, this one, I mean, I just wanted to show some essence because you said, you know, we didn't have time to show like an 8-minute or 10-minute, but I wanted to give a little bit of the flavor because it's also the 1960s. You know, he used all his friends to film and his students at NYU and Warhol superstars and all of that. So there's a lot more to these films and there's a lot more I can say to it, say it. That film is modeled in a way after Hitchcock's Vertigo, because the opening of the film shows a portrait of a woman, which is like Carlotta Valdez. And so in Vertigo, when Jimmy Stewart goes in and sees Kim Novak looking at a picture with her hair in a curl. I should also mention that thanks to Vivian also through her Hollywood series that we presented a retrospective with Chen Scheinberg, who I think is in your department, We co-organized a program which was a couple years ago. We showed at the Jerusalem Cinematheque and the Tel Aviv Cinematheque, which was Warren Sombert in Hollywood, because Warren was well-versed in Hollywood films. And I think as a filmmaker, he is experimental filmmaker. He's kind of unique, because even though other experimental filmmakers like Jonas Mekas and Ken Jacobs know a lot about Hollywood film, Warren was less, he had abstractionist films, but he was less concerned with abstraction as with narrative structure. And he was trying to create a narrative structure in an experimental manner that paralleled commercial cinema. And he has gazillions of references in specific shots, like in that last one I showed you, or in the overall structure of his films. One of his films is modeled after a Douglas Sirk movie, and another one after Alfred Hitchcock. So you can see various tropes, all sorts of things. And, you know, this is like, I acquired Warren Sombert's amphetamine early on at MoMA, and that was back in 1970, I don't know what. And since he passed away, unfortunately, of AIDS in 1995, and I worked on a project with the Estate Project for Artists with AIDS to preserve his film. So, you know, I've been working with a number of filmmakers, you know, in Tribeca Film Festival and so on, but I've been working with his films for 25 years. And one thing we did, and this is just to show you like what Barbara does, and just to give you an idea, but this is a special issue of Framework, which I was guest editor of. The Harvard Film Archive and the Harvard Libraries acquired all of Warren Sombert's papers. And this is a book, all of Warren Sombert's writings. And I think what's really important here is, because it has to do with respect for the artist, like this is his screenplay for Capriccio, but we reproduced everything as he originally wrote it. So it wasn't like, you know, resetting the text and things like this. So it's what makes it even more fascinating. I'll just see if I have one more quick thing I can show you. Like this is the shot list for his films, you know, and he had things marked out and so on forth and so on. So what I was talking about the artist process, like instead of making this nice and neat, you know, typeset, I mean, this is the material that he used on his typewriter. So it's more of the fabric of, like Barbara talked about, the ephemera, which is, I completely agree, this is all important material in terms of how he thought, what he did, how he created what he did.
John, thank you very much. It was really fascinating. And I would like to call Barbara to join us for the joint panel, Barbara and John, talking about this question and the relation between experimental cinema and video art. It's a really crucial question that we ask even in our department as we teach those genres. But in the digital age, everything is blurred. So this is one of the questions, where are we now? Because these, of course, these are separate narratives. Historically, as you mentioned, experimental film beginning in the 20s, and Barbie, as you mentioned, the portaback entering the market, the Sony portaback, jump-started video art in 65. There's a lot in common, but there's a lot of distinction. And I want to go back to your book, Barbara, because, you know, the first distinction would be technology. You know, one is film and one is video. It's different techniques. And this is the way you kind of define mediums in art. And you write in the book, Barbara, as a material, film is light readable, which means that when you hold up a section of processed film, you will see an individual image called frames. If you take a length of videotape, you won't be able to see anything except a brown strap of plastic, which doesn't sound so, it sounds quite, you know, as opposed to light. So this is one distinction you talk about, Barbara, and the second is liveness. So I wanted to hear your take on it. Liveness in video, or what it means, and of course the material as a jumpstart to our talk about the relation between the two. You're muted, Barbara.
Okay.
Here we hear you.
This is a tall order. So yeah, when in the earliest days, when we had experimental video and emerging and experimental filmmakers, we always would talk about the live, that video you could turned on the camera and you saw an image immediately, you could make an installation with a live, in quote, situation. Or you could be in the studio and record an action. If you didn't like it, you'd rewind it, check it, and then redo it. So these are all things that are normal today. And the editing you would do, it was very cumbersome and clumsy in the beginning. I think Nam June called called scotch tape the Tao of video, because he would scotch tape splices together. He didn't really have editing equipment. Nobody did, only television producers did. Film you had to shoot, then you would send it out to a lab to be developed, and you had to wait for it to come back. So there was always that, and the expense of the development. But yet the editing, you could do it as we had, you know, one might have had a steam back or you blah, blah. So the cost, you know, costs were different. Technology keeps improving. So video, the Portapak in the beginning had a grainy, grotty, dirty, grungy looking image. And later, much later, when I was at MoMA and a painting and sculpture curator wanted to put in an early videotape, they'd say, why is it so grungy? And I would say, garbage in, garbage out. You cannot make it look better. It's what it is. So the consumer tools are always lesser than the commercial tools. But the work being made by an independent artist is often in opposition to that commercial system. And I think that was true for both video makers and filmmakers, as John has eloquently said. So then I used to say to my film colleagues, when they would do the new director series, I would say, why aren't you including video makers? You've got new directors. And it was much, much, much later when you're, as you said, Sharon, the blurring. So I think the big distinction now is the more poetic and the individual work and the work and intended for the more commercial distribution. But now we've got so many different, as John was talking about streaming, now we've got so many different means of distribution. And then we've got your students who grew up with a mobile phone. Well, John and I didn't have mobile phones, and long distance phone calls were very expensive. So I couldn't pick up the phone and call Tokyo. I had to write a letter. I had to then wait for the letter to come back. So it was all very different kind of research process. If I learned that somebody was in town from Tokyo, of course I would make time for them. I wanted that information. So I would talk with them. And of course I would talk with almost anybody. I had an open door because otherwise I had no information. So it was people to people, as John said, and these networks form. And that's what I was trying to say to one of your students. There's power in collectivity. You know, alone, you have a voice. But especially when you're emerging or when you're trying to do something that has an impact, how are you going to get that audience? How are you going to do the outreach? And I always would say to either artists or young interns I had who were aspiring curators, I would say, you really need everyone. And you can't be rude to anyone. You know, because it's going to come back and bite you. You know.
Great tip.
Can I add to that?
Yeah.
Can I add to that?
Sure.
Sure, sure.
One very poignant message very early in my career that Adrian Mancha was the curator of programming said to me, I mean, it sounds really silly, but it was incredibly profound. She said, John, you must never forget that without filmmakers, none of us would have careers.
Yeah.
And I think Barbara shares that. And I think Barbara have this bond because, you know, we've both been very active in what we do, but there is a appreciation of the work of the artist, and also that it nourishes us and that we can then use our, and I don't mean this in any arrogant way, but in a passionate way, use our knowledge and experience to give back or to try to articulate what our visions are about these things and to put that out into the world. And I would just add, for me, one of the most profound experiences was going outside of the museum context to program experimental films at the Tribeca Film Festival, because that was a general audience. And basically everybody there in the programming team would talk about what is a crowd pleaser. And I said, it's not about a crowd pleaser. It's about finding excellent films and presenting them to an audience with an open and accessible way. And I was able to build up an audience for these experimental films. And sometimes people would say, well, I don't get what's going on in the film. I said, but you got what went on in the film because you didn't get it, meaning not the typical narrative that's telling you what to think and feel at every minute. So it really honed my skills in being able to talk more about this work to a larger audience. And you know, these are really important things because it's not just imparting what we know, but it's learning from, I think Barbara would agree, from the artists and from the audiences, things that we can, you know, Barbara talked eloquently about that, about, you know, her blind spots. I mean, being able to be open to, you know, how to adjust or modulate what we do or we talk about.
Mm-hmm.
One of my very old friends was a media curator early on, and then she became a museum director. But she and I go to Venice every time there's a biennial, we go together. And she said, Barbara, we always agree, artists are our teachers. And you know, it's like what John said, it's what we learn. And then I learned early on that even if the public didn't understand something that I put in the gallery, they were introduced the same way John says, you know, you don't understand. So then there's a context. So then the next time that person or that family is in the gallery and they think, oh yeah, I remember we saw blah, you know, X, and now they can make a connection. So to me, it's all cumulative, and that's how we learn.
And I just want to add something, like what I would do also at the Tribeca Festival, people would go, some of the other curators, I mean, I love what I did, but they would go and introduce a film and kind of leave. I would like introduce the films with the multiple filmmakers, sit through the whole session and then do the Q&A. And I would then afterwards go to people in the audience and ask them, what did you think? And I never forget, it was a film by Shoja Ajari. And this is very interesting, who is Shirin Nishat, the video artist, partner. And he made a film which is all about his experience, all shot through windows. It was like in 8 different sequences, dealing with like violence in America and being like, you know, coming from the Middle East in the United States. And there was some kid who was writing furiously. And I said, well, what did you think? He said, well, our teacher told us, go to the festival and deal with something with music. So what was very important for me at Tribeca is I didn't have my own section. I programmed experimental films, but they were all embedded in the regular sections of the festival. And this kid said, I'm writing furiously because I never realized that you could have like different music themes in each part of the film, and you could make a movie with the same kind of idea, but like in 8 separate sequences. So his head was opened up and he was excited about seeing that film. And so I felt nourished because I felt like here's a group of films that I'm showing, and here it touched somebody. You know, touch somebody's idea that they were seeing something that they didn't see before, and it opened up their eyes. And those are like sometimes the most satisfying things.
So I wanted to go on and you know, talk about, again, the relation between the experimental film and the video art through gender perspective. And I want to quote something that I was kind of really amazed to read in your book. You were talking about a conference in 1974 called Open Circuits, an International Conference on the Future of TV. And there was a big debate. You mentioned in your talk that experimental films were kind of anxious that the funding will go to video artists. And there was some sense of, for example, Hollis Frampton saying film yields racehorses and video yields wrestlers who lack history. And there's this kind of condescending approach, I think, from film, maybe filmmakers to video because of its junk look. You say junk a lot in your book about the early video. But what amazed me is what Shigeko Kubota said, and this is kind of what I'm getting at in terms of gender issues. I want to read what Shigeko Kubota, the Japanese, New York-based artist, said. Men think, I think, Therefore, I am. I, a woman, feel. I bleed, therefore I am. I recently have bled 10,000 feet of half-inch tape. Every month, video is vengeance and victory of vagina. So what do you think about that? Is video art as a really a place where women felt free to explore as a new genre, to kind of get in and you know, and have their voice, and because it was so anti-institutional, there's something about avant-garde film which is very male-oriented. So what do you think about this? What do you think about this kind of statement that video art is something more female about it in terms of beginning or feminist, and something about the avant-garde was more male-oriented? So John, you're laughing. You're smiling.
Well, I think I can say what drew me to video. I came out of art history, you know, I was intending to do a PhD. I got the job at MoMA and then never did a PhD. I have a master's, but I didn't want to be in a field where everybody was like counting the angels on the head of a pin, you know, to try to find something there for me where I could explore and, you know, move a mountain. So video was this wide open terrain. So yes, indeed, there were men, and quite a few men picked it up. But it was a clean slate. I've written that before. And so like a Beryl Karat, Mary Lucier, Fujiko Nakaya in Tokyo, and Valley Export experimented with it in Austria. And so a lot of women went to it because it was like open territory. Plus a lot of the curators like me were women. Christine Van Asch was at the Pompidou in Paris. My friend Doreen Mignot was at the Stedelijk. So there were a lot of women out there as curators. So I think they were also then sensitive to these gender issues.
May I disagree with Professor Sharon?
No, you may not.
I know we discussed this the other day. Coming from a film perspective, I don't necessarily agree with the idea that it's sort of been more male oriented. Let me put it this way. I think that the gatekeepers for experimental film were maybe more male. And the main point I'm making is that Anthology Film Archives in 1970 set up the Essential Cinema Collection, which was not just experimental film, it was more oriented to that, you know, with that approach, even with commercial cinema, what were kind of experimental elements. But it was started by Jonas Mekas and P. Adam Sitney and James Broughton and Ken Kelman, I believe it was. So it was four men basically who were setting up this, you know, history of cinema. So like Maya Deren was in there, and I believe Marie Mankin, I don't know how many others. But if one really looks at the history, I mean, there are plenty of filmmakers. I mean, Barbara Hammer, for example, began making films in the 60s. So she wasn't then included, and it's only much later before she unfortunately passed away that she's had a lot of career retrospectives. But there are lots of people. I mean, Abigail Child started making films in the 60s or the 70s. Shirley Clark was another one, yes. So there were certain people also who got it kind of anointed, like the Shirley Clark and the Marie Mankin and Maya Deren, but there was also Storm de Hirsch. I mean, I acquired quite a number
of them. Vivian writes, don't forget Annette Michelson next to P. Adam Sidney.
Yes, and what was Vivian's, I'm not sure what Vivian's, and that was my teacher, and P. Adams was my teacher. Yes, and she was-
I meant in the boys' club, on the theoretician side, there was also Annette Michelson.
You mean that she promoted a number of-
Contributed also, yeah.
You mean that she promoted?
I mean, she was part of the group, not only-
Oh, part of the boys' club, yes.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. So, and the other thing is also to point out is that you know, for experimental filmmakers to make money, what they had to do, a lot of them had to teach, which of course was a profession that women could be in, but also quite a number of them were film editors. I mean, Holly Fisher is one, for example, and there are quite a number. And so that was the career then, making films. And I think they took to editing of the assigned jobs, and, you know, because a lot of experimental film deals with the concept of montage, so that they would move into that space. So, you know, I don't know what Vivian thinks, but I really feel it's when one really looks at the wide panorama, even going back to the 60s or 70s, that there were very many women who were dealing with experimental film. It's just that the men were highlighted more.
But you also have to say that what you talked about with the economics was true of the video. Nobody made money. And you had to teach if you were lucky, or you had to, also video people did graphic design, they did editing. And I know many of these artists, Vito Conchi, a lot of them told me, you know, they make no money, so they go and do, in quote, gigs. So Vito and many other artists and filmmakers would go and show their work in Rotterdam and get a pittance, but they would get their airfare. So they would be present. And then they would talk with their other filmmakers, video makers, and then that's how they got information. So that's how Valley Export got a lot of knowledge from her fellow feminists, was going to these festivals. So I think these festivals are very important. And I also talk about that in my book, where you can't know everything. It's impossible. And either you have an open door, or you're fortunate to be able to go to these events.
I will ask one last question before we open it to our listeners and viewers, about scale. There are a lot of issues, but scale, and this brings me to the digital issue. You were saying in your book, when you see a feature film on a cell phone, you know, nothing, it's not relevant anymore, the scale. And you talk about installation as something that is previewing this state of the different scale of viewing the work. And it seems that in video, it's much more flexible, whereas in film, it's kind of more, I would say, in experimental film, and you, John, you would say what you think is kind of more structured, how you have to view the work.
Well, I think a lot of people, many artists, indeed, with video, thought about structure, because the image is, if you see it on a box, on a TV set, it's one thing. If you see it on your dinky phone, it's another. But I think now a lot of this is in the wastebasket, because we're not traveling, and to get information, galleries are closing or they're doing their sales online, and I don't worry about them at all, although I'm sorry that some are closing because of the economics, but we're in a moment of transition. And I think these questions of film versus video, it's artist's intention. And now that 16 millimeter almost doesn't exist, there's probably one lab in all of the world, or a handful, that can do the restoration or the, development. So we're, as a society and as artists or as curators and as writers, we're forced to move on also as the world moves on. And yes, I think there are political issues. There are always political issues. How we have access, who gets access, what's talked about. But I was saying to the student earlier, so there's power in numbers. So, so coming together is important. So I hope that answers.
Mm-hmm. John?
Yeah, I mean, I think also it's interesting, artists who made celluloid films, Vivian is one, Ken Jacobs is another, that then transitioned or had to transition almost by necessity or by, you know, for other reasons, to making works on video or digital born media. And to me, it's also interesting is to watch their process, like how does their process change or their perception change, or their use of the technology change, when they're going from a celluloid based to a, you know, a pixel, I mean, a grain based, film grain based medium to like a pixel medium. So, I mean, I just think there's gazillions of things that can talk about. I think we had a discussion, Vivian, about that a little bit in when you came to New York for your show at Electronic Arts Intermix. So, you know, there's just, like Barbara says also, you start down one path of this and it just opens up all sorts of other ones. But, you know, the other thing that I think is fascinating being curator is that we're dealing with moving images, and it's always interesting to me. It's like the knowledge is like stored in our heads. When you look at a painting or you look at a photograph, you know, you can go to a book or you can reference it online, but all this film history or video art, it's like so much of it has to be sort of stored in our brains. And I just think that's a whole interesting thing because, you know, Barbara's talking about the like magnetic tapes or whatever there were with video, and with film, it's true, you could hold it up to the light, but to really understand it, you had to put it in a projector or a steam back to look at it. And I think it's just an aside, but I think it's different in a certain way from other of the plastic arts, because, you know, it's yes, we can look at photos to refresh our memories, but it's just the accumulated knowledge that kind of sticking in our head, and we each have a known unique kind of register of memory about all these different works that we dealt with.
Well, it's not that different from architecture. You know, like you're talking about a prompt, you know, the still is a prompt. So a video still or a film still, that's a prompt for somebody who either wants to know about the work or already knows about it. And as you say, it's stored in their mind. So architecture, you know, has that problem also, that it's experiential, and in a way it's time-based because you've got to walk through a space and walk through different spaces. So I think installation is that way. You can get, remember when I studied art history, you know, you could look at the art book everybody as an undergraduate had was Alfred R. Janssen's History of Art, and there would be a little postage stamp image of a painting. At least I was in New York, I could walk over to the Metropolitan Museum or walk over to MoMA and see a work in the original. But not everybody has that luxury.
Right, and it's also fascinating because one can also use film to understand architecture a little more as well, because, and it was actually interesting what Barbara said, because I think it was the, we brought into the collection Richard Serra's Railroad Turnbridge, but I think at that point it was the painting and sculpture department that got the money to buy it. You know, this whole thing about departmental divisions. But the, and so one can look at how he dealt with sculptural space in film, and also like we distribute the works of Heinz Emmickholz, who is very much concerned with the representation of architectural space through film. So I think it also relates to what Barbara's talking about. It's like, there's so many different artists dealing with so many different, I think what Barbara was trying to convey is different concerns or different issues, that one can go down different paths, or this gentleman who's researching politics in cinema or video. I mean, there's just all sorts of rich associations. And I think that's also interesting. And I mean, I'm sure it's true for painting and so on, but one could take one film or one video work and reference it or contextualize it in other histories. Like I think of like La Jetée by Chris Marker. Like, you know, one can deal with that as a movie dealing with like the issues of still photography, but you can deal with it also in like the French New Wave, or one could deal with it in terms of science fiction, or one can deal with it in terms of, you know, the idea of memory. So that's the richness to me also for moving image works, is the way that these works can open up, the work of the artist can open up into different threads of investigation.
So I think that's the beauty of a museum, and I'm sure in Jerusalem and Tel Aviv, I know Tel Aviv has, both cities have big contemporary collections, but then it's like how a curator can not just have an Israeli gallery, but a contemporary gallery, and a gallery that's got painting, photography, and crosses, and could be international, it could be looking at, as John says, the thematics or, and that's the beauty of having a collection is then you can rotate. And of course it takes money to have your staff take something off the wall, put it in storage and then put something else up. So yes, so you can
So let's, if it's okay, open some question for viewers, because a lot of them want to ask. So Sal, you wanted to ask something?
Yeah, thank you very much for Barbara and John, and thank you for giving us time and your efforts to get to know history firsthand. That is precious, and I will think through my whole degree, I will keep it in my mind and always remember this, I would say convention, this guy. So my question is that, you, Barbara, and John are curators, and you grew up and developed through an era which curacy, I think I'm saying this right, that the act of curating was needed. People went to the museum, people went to the galleries. They needed someone, per se, to collect all of those memories and works and everything. But right now, especially in a very subversive way, materials and artworks are not curated or needed to be created to the masses. The masses choose their own path. The masses choose their own subjects to develop and understand. Right now, typically in the age of TikTok, YouTube, Instagram, artists are breaking through the walls of bureaucracy and knowing people and connections. What is being curator right now in this era? Does being creator is still something that is, I'm not disrespecting and I love your work, but is curating is something that is needed in this era? Do you think that the way that material is being spread these days is more democratic, is more accessible? What is curating in this area, in this era for you?
Well, I think indeed it's, the work is certainly much more accessible, but with so much out there, how do you reach somebody or how do you target, you know, it's out there and then how does it get written about, or is it just out there along with the funniest videos that are up online as well, or, you know, there are all kinds of goofy things that are up there. So I think there's still a role for whether you call them a curator, even a shoe store. I was always surprised somebody called the person who arranged the display in the shoe store a curator. So curating is making selections, right? So I think through blogs or, you know, or Instagram, there are individuals, tastemakers, or, you know, it's happening in a way that way. And now that we have COVID, museums and film societies, they're all trying to keep up and to try to keep up with the new technologies to do, in effect, curating or programming or bringing your attention. And I think we need the young generation like you to get in there to do it as well. Because I think, you're out there, you're using these tools in a very different way. I think some of us have to take the lead from you guys on how to deal with now the next iteration.
Yeah, there's one thing
John,
I would
yes, add. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, Barbara, were you finished, Barbara?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I mean, I agree that it's to the questioner that the artist does not need the curator now to reach a wide audience, but I think there's one thing that is missing in all of this, and it's that a trained curator, it's the issue of quality, that just because works are readily accessible doesn't necessarily make them good or make them have a kind of excellence. That's not to say that they don't serve an interest or a connection to the between the artist and the audience directly. But the example I give, for example, with Tribeca, there would be lots of films and people would write me, or I'd look at the descriptions of the films and somebody say, this is an experimental film. And there was like one shot out of focus. well, that's not an experimental film. So with our curatorial background, it's, you understand, you know, experimental film or video, it's dealing with the treatment of time, it's dealing with treatment of space. And I think what really gets lost is the notion of a standard of quality. And I do not mean anything elitist. I just mean this search for excellence. And I think Barbara and I think Barbara would agree, we're both working at the museum and starting when there was still that great tradition. I know my teachers were some of the students of the founders of, you know, the MOMA, like we have in our institutional memory, that tradition of kind of excellence and rigor. And I think that that the openness is really great. And I agree with Barbara, there's things we can learn about what younger people are interested in, and it is a different world from us. But at the same time, I think we cannot lose sight that just because somebody, you know, just because something is said to be something doesn't make it good, or doesn't make it excellent, or does not necessarily make it, totally okay to disseminate it without any kind of critique of the work itself. So I think there is a role of curators to help shape the perceptions, but maybe the curators are like somebody like you who has access to all this material and can filter, because Barbara did say something very important, and it's a huge problem, and it's come up in the International Federation of Film Archives and in the American Association of Archives, the idea of selection. You know, like there could be a massive material in there, but everybody is making a selection. And so what are the criteria for making a selection? And my thing always is, sometimes people do things, but they don't ask themselves, why are they doing what they're doing? Like, you know, I took, and I don't mean this to vaunt myself in any way, but when I acquired those films at MoMA, and in 1979, I did a show, I took a week's vacation to write about each of those films. I'm not saying that what I wrote was great at that point, but it was like, you know, to try to stand behind what I was saying or doing. And it doesn't mean that somebody else wouldn't completely disagree and say something else, but that's fine. And so I think to me, it's the idea of, and again, I'm not saying from a lead point of view, but to justify what are you doing, why you're doing, why it's being done. And I think lots of times now people just throw things up and hope that it sticks to the wall. And to me, that's not the same thing as, you know, dealing with art, artistic quality, and such issues. I don't know if you disagree, the person who asked the question, or you take issue with that, but
do you have more questions? So, sorry, do you want let's move on to more questions? Okay, you wanna say something?
First of all, I want to thank you both very much for the time and effort, and thank you for answering my humble question. I'm just taking it all in and trying to combine your point of view to my very subversive queer agenda, because, you know, in my own culture, in my own body, in my own embodiment, the subversive is the one that I'm always looking for. But I am trying to add all of your point of views and trying to shape a new wider opinion. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Sam. Noah Barel, a third-year student, wanted to ask. Noah, where are you?
Thank you. So I wanted to ask, I mean, we talked a lot about the progress of video art with the technological progress. So I wanted to ask, do you have any insight on the progress or the future of video artists in a world where everyone is making video? I mean, it's accessible more than ever. We use it all the time. So my question is, do you have any insight on what the uniqueness of artists, or what is the role of the artist, or specifically video artist, in a society where everyone is so-called content creators? And yeah, like what is the uniqueness of being an artist in opposed to just live in this world right now?
Well, I think John said it very clearly. When I was starting out, there was the Polaroid camera, or there was a little teeny brownie camera. Everybody was taking home photos and everybody was doing home movies. Not everybody was an artist, but yet there was a glut of images and a glut. And there were festivals in Tokyo for these works, and that's fine. You can then sell more technology if you've got more people using it, right? But I think there's the selecting processes. And so I would always say when I was at MoMA all those years, if somebody came to me and said they were artists, I would say, wonderful, I'm so happy to meet you. But maybe I wouldn't show the work for various reasons. Maybe it didn't fit exactly what I was very involved with at that moment. Or maybe I thought it didn't come together in a very coherent way. So as I said before, a good work to me is maybe what another curator wouldn't see as a good work, but at least there are many curators out there, or institutional ones, and even ones doing blogs, or even ones doing other things. So you have different opportunities, or you have different points of view, and each one is going to say, I chose this in terms of the strength of the statement, the quality, blah, blah, blah. So, yeah. John, and also, I think the most important thing is that it's artists. And yes, you could say video artists. Yes, you could say media artists. But to me, the bottom line is artists. And an artist is making a statement that's not what television does, or it's not what, the magazine industry or the former magazine industry is doing. It's not, anyway, end there.
Any more questions?
I actually have two questions that I'm really curious about. So the first one is, regarding technological constant progress, I would like to ask you how important, if at all, is analog old technology when it comes to showing avant-garde films or older video artworks? Is it possible to show Andy Warhol's screen test on a digital projector or a Nam June Paik on a flat screen?
So these are important questions. And if Nam June were alive, he would be drawn into the discussion. MoMA, at a point, I forget, 15 years ago, took all of the analog videos and very carefully moved them over to digital. Of course, everything was kept. So there's still the submaster, the analog submaster. So there's always the possibility of going back. And the aesthetics are very different. As you well know, the analog has a very particular look and the digital has another. And of course now, and this is what's going on with the film video discourse, filmmaking in Hollywood now is almost, 99.9% digital. We're in a digital era. And the technology is going to continue to race forward and continue to do things that, interactivity or, it's a lot to keep up with.
John? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's a really great question. And I don't know that there's any set answer to this issue. I come from the celluloid background, because also I worked with nitrate film at MoMA going back, and even now we work with archival collections. We sold the collection to Australia with nitrate film that dated from the 1920s with a beautiful image, and that's my background. And I love the luminosity of the celluloid, and I love the sense of grain. That's what I was sort of dealt with, but I think for me, what really affected my career is after MoMA, when I worked at Broadway Video, because at Broadway Video produced Saturday Night Live, which was a video-based, production.
Production.
But Lorne Michaels, who was the head of the company, also bought the copyrights to Lassie and Lone Ranger, which were American TV series and tons of films. But basically, it was the end when I came in, which was 1991, of sending those around to TV stations in 16 millimeter. So it was then just the issue which I got immersed in, which was the whole idea of representing celluloid-based material in a video format. So I think if I had not left MoMA, I would probably not have this been able to make these shifts to understand, you know, 2-inch and 1-inch and, you know, cleaning up a video, all of these things. So I would say my preference is to always try to show the 16mm for experimental films in that format. But the point is that we're in a reality now of a digital era. For example, our DVD distribution, I mean, nobody really rents 16mm films anymore. So it's distributed on DVD, and now it's not even the DVD because of COVID, which is one reason why we launched GME Streamline, because now it's like we have to represent these works in a digital file. But I think, you know, there's a time and place for each. So for Warren Sombert, for example, we distributed through Lightcone in Paris, his 16mm retrospective of his films in 16mm, which went to the Tate Modern, the Pompidou, and a whole bunch of other countries. But now I kind of feel like, okay, that's sort of penny. And now it's okay to show works digitally. I think I was much more of a purist when I was at MoMA, but the reality of being in the world and being in Broadway video, and you know, in terms of the dissemination, it's on video, you just reach a larger audience.
So I want to make a, yeah. I want to make a point here about installation. The artist Mary Lucier has very laboriously gone back and restored all of her single channel work. So she's gone to the, you know, extremes of going from analog to digital. She's doing it, so it's her aesthetics. She also knew that her installations, which had many sculptural parts and many projections, that she was going to be dead in the water, that nobody, no museum was going to want to acquire that work, was going to want to show it because it was too complicated. So she streamlined her own work. So in a way, she streamlined, but she would put the date. I forget if they, she made it in 1995, and she would put the hyphen or the slash and then put the date of when she restored it and then, you know, upgraded to this physical version that's different from the original. So either she was going to be ignored, forgotten, passed by, or she was going to bite the bullet and say, if I want my work to be shown in a museum, I have to change.
And I would also, if I could just add one more quick thing, Sharon. You know, for Warren Sombert, for example, because I started as an archivist, my first thing to do was to get his films preserved at the Motion Picture Academy on celluloid. That was the very first step. So I feel that all of these other issues of creating digital copies of them are not strictly the preservation of the work. The preservation is celluloid, and that's already done. This methodology is described in the fragile emotion. So I also feel freer. It's like a done honor to the filmmaker by having his films preserved in celluloid. And now there's just a media for distributing them. And that's a distinction too, in my mind, between preservation and distribution. The distribution and the reception of the material is not necessarily the same thing as the preservation, the form in which both are dealt with.
Big issue of media preservation. Ifat, do you have another question?
Yeah, I have another one. I mean, you're working with so many artists and filmmakers coming from different cultures and backgrounds, and your groundbreaking practice is so inspiring and influential. So just, I mean, looking back at this field, over the last decades, what stands out for you personally?
Oh, wow.
It's almost what kid you like most?
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. I'm really curious.
Well, I never ever like to single out individuals, because it's everybody who has shaped, you know, so many artists shape my practice. And every moment when there's a political change or a technological change, that opens up doors in certain ways. You know, we have to leave old ideas or say, okay, that's an old idea and I have to grow. I have to grow. So probably that's the most exciting part over my career of learning and learning how to be patient, generous. You know, if I were so dogmatic, I wouldn't have been able to do what I did.
I would probably say, from my observation, without talking about individuals or anything, I would say from a curator's point of view, I would say probably maybe the biggest change I would see is a certain lack of curatorial rigor.
Hmm.
And you know, it's interesting because, for example, on our website where we distribute DVDs, not all of which we produce, they're from other publishers, but often those publishers of the DVDs don't necessarily write like long descriptions. So I sort of make it a point in my head to like do the research and write more about them. And what I'm saying is like somebody could completely disagree with what I've written, but at least I've taken a position. I don't mean that in any negative way, but you know, it's sort of to assert what the point of view is. And, you know, Barbara has a point of view and her point of view, you know, spiritually, I think we're connected, but her point of view or perspective might be different from mine, but that's fine. But there's a point of view. It's not, there's no point of view.
So the one thing to add, there are all kinds of museum studies programs. And I know there's one up at Bard College in the States, but I have only seen sometimes coming out of that, like what John is talking about, the lack of rigor that, you know, yes, you can take A and B and C and put it together, but the why or, you know, like you, and not to get so hung up on this theory, that theory, another theory, but to say, yes, those are the theories and those are reinterpretations of older work or those are ways of analyzing or studying. But it's one way, and understand that sometimes there are blinders through those methods. So understand where your blinders are.
Thank you. Any more questions? We're about to end this amazing.
Could I just say respond to
hear you? Yes, sure.
The young fellow who was talking about queer is, I don't know, is he still there? The queer.
I think so. Sal, are you there?
So, yeah, I'm here. Luckily, I'm here. I had some funny business in my hotel. I'm sorry.
Okay. So I wanted to just say something to you. A couple things to say. First of all, I'm gay. I don't know if that makes any difference to you, but it's like I also think like being gay as, you know, potential, you know, also being a woman, it's like, you know, you understand the difference from the heterosexual male hierarchy, which and I think in some ways psychically enables one to see different things from a different perspective or maybe from an experiment, you know, it makes one more readily able to deal with experimental work. But I can tell you, like in the United States, there are many, many people dealing with curating works with like a queer background. I mean, the head of the film department now, Raj Roy, is gay. So I'm not just saying that he's gay, but I'm saying that there's a space for you if that's your interest to stake out part of what you want to do or say. The other thing I'll say about Warren Somberg, I mean, some people say he's bisexual, but he was basically gay. I made the decision in showing his works to not show them in gay film festivals or in like gay collecting institutions, but to show them in art museums. So it took me a lot longer, but his work is not so much gay. There's gay issues like the boy kissing in the films, but that's not what he was about. He was about, you know, a modern artist dealing with things. So that's why I decided to put the films in the Tate Modern or get the show in the Beaubourg. So what I'm saying is that doesn't mean you have to do that. It just means thinking, again, I think what Barbara and I are talking about is who is the artist or what is this material and what is also the right fit for it? You know, it's not like to me, and that's part of the issue about the dissemination of everything everywhere. Sometimes like, you know, to me, it like, sometimes it's important to have a niche. It's like, at Broadway Video, once I got laughed at because we got a rental for a film that was shown at Film Forum. And they were saying, why are you wasting your time getting a $500 rental? We should be dealing with thousands of dollars. But Adrian Mancha, who was one of my mentors, said, John, if there's one person sitting in that audience who gets inspired by that movie that is very meaningful. You know, and I think that's what Barbara and I are trying to do. It's about touching people as curators. It's about touching. It's not about our egos in a way. It's about trying to touch people. Touch, you know, Barbara, I think you would agree, you know, touch them by what we do, by the beauty of the work. I don't know if that helps you in terms of what we're saying.
Yeah, what you're saying is very important and very sentimental. But through my academy work, I search and look for the, we talk about political identities and the identities like war or fight per se, especially these days with the rise, when I say the rise of queerness, not only in a very sexual orientation way, but gender wise, you know, they're non-binary people, gender non-conforming people, we're called transvestites per se, we're always there since the beginning of history. But with the world of arts, which was very male dominated, heterosexual dominated, and after the gay revolution, the trans and gender in a non-binary way discussion still hasn't risen or hasn't risen enough. And if we're talking about queer and queer art history, as I studied it through academic essays and books, I discovered that even after the gay artists and curators has risen, they tried to kind of simmer down a very radical gender, I'm sorry for the word, that's the word, gender fuck narratives, because there was still the effort to normalize or to make art accessible worldwide and gay agenda worldwide more accessible. And I'm coming to
I think, you know, it was really interesting to hear the reaction. Do you want to react, John? And we will
I just
want
to say
questions.
One thing,
we have
you could write me offline, but I think you've just found your space. That's your space. You know, you are, you know, when you deal with experimental film or I think video art, you are pushing the boundary. So you have made an analysis of what goes on, and that's maybe the space for you to assert that. And maybe that's where you can find your place.
That was very inspiring for me. Thank you, John, for your time and effort to answer me, little me. Thank you.
Okay. Big you, not little you. Iris, please.
Okay, hi. It's an honor for me. I'm not from Bezalel. I used to be. It's an honor for me to talk to Barbara London because I studied her. Barbara, where are you? I studied you and I taught you also. I'm an art video artist from the 80s. And actually I experienced the whole range of video art going from the 70s until now. And I think if looking at the 50 years, as much as I do, with my work or without my work, doesn't matter, video art started as a reaction or an activist artist against media and economics and politics and everything, you name it, like Godard. I think it's important to mention Godard because he's above any medium. For him, the cut makes the politics. So now, today, when I talk about, in the beginning of the of 2000, video art made the shift, made the shift towards the need to be accepted. Now we are in a junction of breaking systems all over. I mean, not only in medical systems, cultural systems, everything. So when we look back at the video art as an activist and critical movement.
Do you hear?
We look now, and we look now at the moment when the internet is helping us to be individual, and like Sal said, what is the function of a system now? I don't want to come back to the period when feudals moved had in the French Revolution had to release their private collections to the museums, and now the museums actually hold their collections behind the audience. So I would really like to hear your opinion about it, Baba.
Well, first of all, I think from the beginning, and I think even the beginning with experimental film, that's not my field, although I've watched a lot, that all these artists are about breaking systems. Nobody was happy with television. Nobody was happy with Hollywood. Nobody was happy with the gallery system. So, you know, they were always pushing, finding alternatives. And the thing about media and film, it's if either it's an unlimited edition and it means it can get out to all of the students at the Bezalel Academy, or it can get into the hands of collectors who don't have a lot of money, or it's a limited edition and then multiple museums can have it or collectors. So yeah, either we're dealing with the precious object, or we're dealing with something that's precious to us because of the statement it's making, or you know, or the radical position it's taking. So I think it can still break. We still have the need to break systems.
I know it's kind of getting late, and there are some more questions. But I feel that you're probably it's been a while now. So just if you can finish with tips for the young artists. There's a question here. Any tips for young creators and artists? Going forward with their artistic lives.
Why don't you say tricks? I don't think there are any tricks.
Tips.
Tips.
That's a question here. Tips. But maybe there's a trick also. That would be nice. Yeah.
So to me, like I've said multiple times, the whole thing of the network, paying attention to your professors, whether that's Sharon or others in the university or the school, and then pay attention to the people who come and visit, and try to get to know them. And maybe then they'll open some kind of door for you, whether that's new thinking, or they may recommend an article or something to look at. So those are always my tips to make great work. Really don't throw something out fast. Take time, spend time. You know, figure out what your ideas are. Figure out how you can push these tools to something that makes a statement that's individual and unique to you. Because that's what, like, John or I would be looking for, is how you've moved the tool, how you've made a statement, what you've said, how you've said it. Pay attention. Work hard. That's what I would say.
John?
I'd just say a couple of things. Following up on what Barbara said is, number one, I would say one thing I would say is mentorship. I was very fortunate to have mentors through my entire career, even today. And I think I don't know how much that is. I sometimes feel that a lot of young people where jobs aren't constant and anything like this are sort of despairing, you have to sort of make do on your own. But I think if one can find a mentor, whether that's another older artist or it's a professor or a curator, that that's really important because there's just so much to be learned from mentors. And the other thing I would say is, because I think you're all studying in the video art field, you know, and like in film field, it can become very trendy, but I think, you know, that's not about what you're taught, how to be trendy, but the issue is, you know, to always pursue excellence. And I think it's also, it's like part of the situation, like this is the world we're in. And so we accept it and we always have to push the boundaries. And I think Barb is a little underestimating what she did in the museum in this huge structure. I mean, it was very brave of her. I mean, she was working in the
media and performance
department, and she gave that up to go do video. And then, like she said, all these no's, but she kept pushing. And it's like filmmakers, you know, or video artists, it's like they have to do what they do. They can't do anything else. I mean, I don't mean they're not capable of doing something else. I mean, that's what inspires them. So I think it's just like, you know, you're in this world, and yes, there are obstacles and there are boundaries and all this stuff, but okay, you know, this is the world we're in. And so, you know, you do the best of your ability, push the boundaries, move things aside. I mean, Barbara is an admirable paradigmatic example. I mean, she's sort of underplaying all the struggles and things, you know, but it was, I know for her, you know, she was very focused and it was a tough road, but she, you know, all these things she was told she couldn't do, or, you know, even, you know, I mean, that, like I say, it's very brave, I think, when she went into video art. I mean, she had to create that within a film department, create it autonomously, give up all the background that she, not give up the background, but, you know, move in another direction in a structure that was not necessarily really open to it. So, but that's what she sort of chose. So she moved through it. And I think that's the point.
Thank you, John. And thank you. I think, you know, it's we have to end this talk, although I'm sure everyone here have a lot of more questions and we would love to hold on to your presence. But thank you so much. You know, it was really amazing, so valuable. We heard so many things we need to process and kind of take in, and it resonates so beautifully with what we do here in our program, and it's just it was fascinating. I really want to thank you, Barbara, for your generosity, for having us, for having the time to talk to us and talk about the book. It was really, really valuable for us, and I really appreciate it. And John as well, thank you so much for being with us, and thank you for recommending Barbara's book and helping make this beautiful event happen. So this is your beginning of your day. It's nighttime, evening time here. So enjoy the rest of your day, and goodbye everyone. And thank you.
thank you so much.
Thank you.
Good.
Thank you,
Barbara, John. Amazing. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Nice to see everybody.
Yeah, everybody now is disappearing into the sphere.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm happy you turned out.
Vivian, where are you, Vivian? Well, it's still very a day in Paris.
It was very worthwhile.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for helping me connect these two. It's amazing.
Barbara, I just got your book as a present mailed to me 2 days ago.
Oh, wonderful.
So I'm going to dive into it. It looks
beautiful. Great. I remember we met very briefly at Electronic Arts Intermix at the screening of Annabella Geiger, I think.
Yes, you were trying to rein her in, succeed.
She was like, I know her, and it was hard.
It's always hard.
Oh, great. Okay. Well, thank you, everybody. Wonderful students and wonderful colleagues. So.
Great question.
Yes, they are. They are amazing, really amazing students, and do beautiful, beautiful work. And by the way, Cili Charney, I don't know if she's here, her camera is on, but we showed a lot of their work last year on this billboard also in Times Square, and it was really amazing. Beautiful work they've done during COVID, the first lockdown, and it's really something to work with them. So I'm so happy we could make it this event for them. I think it's really, really important.
Yeah.
So
Thank you.
Thank you. I will be in touch. And bye bye. I'm closing the Zoom. Bye bye.
I look forward to staying in touch. Okay. Bye.
Yes, we will. Bye.
Bye.